Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. Joining me tonight are Amanda Crawford of Bloomberg News, Howard Fisher of Capital Media Services, and Jim Small of the Arizona Capital Times. Big immigration news coming out of the White House today. Amanda, let's get started with this. This is basically work permits for those who are DREAM Act eligible, correct?
Yes, it's sort of administratively moving towards the DREAM Act that didn't get through the Senate last year. And certainly, as you know, we can expect, this has turned very political very quickly. It was well timed by the president, if you're in some camps, to correspond with the Supreme Court's impending decision on SB 1070, our Arizona immigration law, and to, you know, diffuse the criticism that the president's been getting for the last couple of years that he's done nothing when it comes to immigration, and nothing to win over the Latino supporters that he had in the last election. And certainly those Latino voters have become very key in this election against Mitt Romney. It's not like Mitt Romney is necessarily doing things to draw people who care about immigration reform in that area. But
and this is really crucial, because when I was talking to Raul Grijalva, he said, look, Latino community was promised a lot of stuff by this man. And if you look at a recent Pew Hispanic survey of the Latino community, they, by 59 to 27 margin, they disagree with the president's policy. And 41% of those asked said that they were aware that there were more people deported each year under Obama than under Bush. And that got their attention. He said, look, we're finally going to get some action. And it's about time, and that action should pay off in votes in November, assuming the Latinos come out and vote, which has been a big if.
And I want to get to more of the political aspect of this in a second. But as far as the nuts and bolts are concerned, what, under the age, it had to have been brought here under the age of 16, and you can't be older than 30 right now, among the many variables here?
Right, and you had to have been in the country, I think, for 5 years, and you have to have a high school diploma or a GED, and no criminal record, and not a threat to national security, which means you're not on, you know, a terrorist no-fly list or anything like that. So it is, you know, in a lot of ways, like the DREAM Act was, you know, like that legislation was, is designed to try to be narrowly, you know, aimed at a narrow segment of the population, not like what happened in 1986, you know, where they just basically granted, you know, amnesty and path to citizenship for just about everybody who was here.
And what's crucial, though, and the real key difference with this and the DREAM Act, is that all it does is say, we won't go after you. The president in a speech said, A, this isn't amnesty, because, you know, that's the word all the Republicans are throwing out. Doesn't grant you legal status, doesn't grant you a path to citizenship. It is simply us exercising discretion, which we've already done in terms of going after the most high-profile cases, and we're not going to go after you. You apply for this and get a two-year permission to stay, and then every 2 years you renew it. Which gets, of course, to the question of,
yes,
do you apply for it?
Yeah, who is going to apply, A, and B, if you go ahead and do say, my name is Ted, I came into the country, blah, blah, I apply, I'm okay. Do I want to vote into office a political party or group of folks that are going to come after Ted because he registered and said, you got to get out?
Well, I think that we should view this as what it is, which is a stopgap measure. It's a stopgap measure between now and the election, really. I mean, the pressure will be on Obama, if he gets reelected, to do something through Congress on immigration reform. And the best chance to do something that controversial is obviously right after your major elections, before the campaigning begins again. He missed that opportunity when he took office the first time. So this is a chance to kind of win over some voters who think there needs to be some progress on immigration reform, and a safe way to do it. When you look at the polls, even Americans and Arizonans who support SB 1070 are rather strict immigration law here that the Supreme Court will be taking up, those voters overwhelmingly support the DREAM Act, because the majority of Americans don't want to see some kid who came here at, you know, 2 years old and with his mother be deported to a country he's never been to.
They may overwhelmingly support this, but Jim, as far as the reaction so far from Republicans, almost uniform, Mitt Romney of all people has been somewhat muted in his criticism, but a lot of other folks from the right, very, very, I mean, Governor Brewer, this is outrageous, mm-hmm. These sorts of responses.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, in Arizona especially, I mean, I think that may be the difference between the national stage and here. But, you know, I mean, in Arizona, immigration is still an important factor in Republican primaries. And we've got a Republican primary coming up in about, you know, 10 weeks. So you've got a lot of people who don't want to appear soft on that issue at all. And a lot of that is that no amnesty, and anything that even has the whiff of amnesty the whiff of giving anything other than deporting everybody is immediately kind of blackballed.
Well, and that's the key. In the campaign, though, too. There's Republicans are not going to come out and say anything nice about this. It didn't matter what the president said today, really. There was not going to be a Republican that came forward, none of the really political ones right now in the heat of this campaign that were going to say, yeah, that's reasonable. That's a reasonable policy.
But I don't even think after November. I mean, look, assuming we'll have to see who maintains control of the House, what the Senate looks like, because you need 60 votes to get anything out of there. Look how many politicians on the Republican side have had to walk back. Jeff Flake, I never supported anything like this.
John McCain.
That wasn't my name on the sponsor of that bill with Ted Kennedy. And it remains poison within the GOP. Now, it may be, as you said, that with an election 2 or 6 years off, For representatives or senators, maybe it's a safe time. But this is going to remain toxic as long as people believe it's the economy. Look, the question is, if you have perhaps 800,000 people being given legal permission to work, we have an unemployment rate in Arizona in excess of 8%. People are going to say, well, no wonder we can't get the jobs because the illegals that the Obama administration is allowing are taking them.
Okay, let's play this out then. The Latino vote in Arizona, the Latino vote nationally, the conservative vote in the primaries, the vote in November general. Give us a dynamics here with something like this coming through.
I mean, if you look at the people who are going to vote against Obama because of what he did today, they weren't going to vote for him anyway. So I think that that's still rather safe for Obama. Where it became unsafe is in the Republican primary. Like I said, a Republican coming out and supporting Obama right now, we're not in that kind of climate. And I really do think that immigration in general, immigration policy, is one of the areas where this huge divide politically and this stalemate we've come to politically is really hurting the country. Everyone on every side agrees that policies need to be changed, and we're in this perpetual campaign cycle where nothing can be done, even things that the majority of Americans agree on, because you have to attack the person on the other side because of the party name behind their name. And this is a really good example of that.
What's been really interesting is watching Mitt Romney on this. I mean, on one hand, during the debates, when he was trying to prove he was further right than anybody else, he said, I would veto a DREAM Act. Well, some of my colleagues caught up with him today. Well, you know, the problem with the president's plan is that it's not permanent. And if I am elected president, I will work toward a permanent solution. Leaving aside the policy issue, leaving aside that they're illegal, so he's been listening a little bit to Marco Rubio,
but that's
recognizing that there are some angles there.
Yes, and that's what I was making the point earlier, Jim, was the fact that folks that aren't necessarily in a primary anymore, Mitt Romney, mm-hmm. are not nearly as harsh on this as others. And again, once you get past that primary for Republicans, you got a general election to worry about. And now all of a sudden, if the pundits are, if the tea leaves are showing what they're supposed to be showing, there's a big Latino possibility for turnout.
Well, there's always a big Latino possibility for turnout. And I think that's the thing. It has failed to materialize. I mean, the last decade or more.
Does this change that?
I don't know. I mean, we'll find out. I mean, it's something that Latino groups have made a large effort to try to get people, to register to vote. And now that they've done that and they've made a lot of inroads in that area, it's a matter of getting them to actually show up at the polls. And so it'll be a challenge. And it's been a long haul. And certainly Democrats in Arizona are making that a priority. I mean, look at Richard Carmona. Look at there's a lot of things that are going on. I mean, Carmona is seen in a lot of ways as maybe the entree into getting Hispanics to show up for a statewide election where they haven't really had a Hispanic statewide candidate in a long time.
And the other piece of the problem, though, but look, if they didn't show up after 1070, we saw the marches, the signs, today we march, tomorrow we vote. Alfredo Gutierrez was out there saying, this time it's going to happen. This time we're going to come out. Did you check the results of the last couple of elections? If 1070 itself, an Arizona bill aimed at Arizona Latinos, couldn't get them out. DREAM Act?
But I don't know if that's going to... I'm not sure if many people look at Arizona and think it's in play, even if the Latino turnout comes out. I think that there are other states that are considered more swing than Arizona, like Nevada and Colorado, where the Latino vote could make an actual difference. Not that it couldn't make a difference here. I don't want to underplay that. But I don't think that we're the top when it comes to the swing state that this is hoping to win over. And I do think that there is no issue that has mobilized... kind of across the board, people want immigration reform like the DREAM Act. We really are seeing, at a speech that Mitt Romney made here, major DREAM Act protests. This is what a lot of people are portraying as the logical part that we can get done and agree on.
With that in mind, how does it impact down-ticket votes? in Arizona?
I think that anything that gets people motivated to vote for Democrats who weren't going to necessarily show up because they were disillusioned with this president helps Richard Carmona. And then it will help down ticket any congressional contest as well. But that remains to be seen. Are people going to turn out and vote down ticket?
Right.
Just turn out and vote for Obama.
But the other half of the shoe that may drop as early as Monday, of course, is SB 1070. And how does that affect it? I mean, you've got races like the race between Worsley and Pierce out in Mesa. And, you know, Worsley's saying, I'm the moderate, I'm going to work together. And depending on what the court says, I mean, I think the court's going to split the baby. They're going to allow them to enforce the quote-unquote papers, please thing and probably, you know, get rid of the rest of it. Now, how does that play with the voters? Is this what they want? Do they want to revisit 1070?
How does this play with 1070 enforcement? What are we hearing regarding that?
Well, this is where you go down the rabbit hole, because several of us have, you know, talked to the usual law professors, and you've got this question of if, in fact, you're getting a work permit from the federal government, does that make you here legally? Well, the president says no, but you are getting a federal permit. The more practical effect, and when I talked to folks at Homeland Security, I said, look, here's what's going to happen. Let's assume a Maricopa County Sheriff's deputy pulls somebody over. They say they're in deferred prosecution. The deputy says you're here illegally. They call ICE. ICE looks at the list, says you're under deferred prosecution. Let them go. So I don't think it affects it that way.
But this goes back to the administration's argument in the SB 1070 case, which is your state laws interrupt what we want to do. And the fact that we're having that conversation, that the federal government has made a decision to going forward, or at least the Obama administration, how to deal with DREAM Act eligible youth, the state law may still be picking them up and arresting them. And that comes back to the whole administration argument that the state law contradicts and conflicts with their ability to enforce immigration policy. And that might be part of the calculus here, that we're going to see that happen.
Indeed. And before this even came down, Jim, we had the governor basically telling law enforcement around the state, I want to get that video back out there so you guys know what you're doing. Once the Supreme Court, and of course the governor's office sees the Supreme Court is validating everything they do, but if that were to occur, we want to get law enforcement ready to go. Now, how many videos are going to be out there after what happened today? I mean, it's going to be a carousel.
Well, yeah, they may have to go back and redo that video. I know we talked to Lyle Mann at the Police Officer Standards and Training, who they certify all the law enforcement officers. And he basically said, well, I don't know what's going on. I can't tell you. You have to call the governor's office. They're going to, you know, they can tell you what's going on. And I think really it's just so fresh. No one really knows what's happening. I would imagine at some point in the next couple of weeks, a post is going to have to go through this and figure out, okay, how does this executive order kind of jive with 1070 and with the Supreme Court ruling?
And we're going to have to see how much time we've got, because the Supreme Court can do one of two things in terms of issuing an order. They can immediately dissolve the injunction, assuming they allow it to some parts to take effect, in which case, theoretically speaking, police can go out and enforce it. Or they can do the procedural thing, which is direct Judge Bolton, who issued the original injunction, to dissolve it. Now, that could take a couple of weeks, which would give a little breathing room to figure out how this fits together.
One thing is for sure, the ACLU will be watching, and they are saying, don't you mess this up, because we're ready to take you to court at the first sign of what they call rogue officers.
And I love that language.
Case pending.
Yeah, and well, I love this rogue officers argument that somehow some policeman's going to get up, listen to the news at noon and say, I'm going to go out and find me an illegal. I think the officers know not to do that. This is a little bit of saber rattling. And as Amanda pointed out, there are four cases pending. This case deals with one issue, which is federal preemption. That's all it deals with. And it's a facial challenge, i.e. the law is written. You still have the questions of First Amendment rights, illegal search and seizure, 14th Amendment equal protection. You have the as-applied challenge, which is going to come, which is, if we let you enforce the law, are you going to enforce it in a way that isn't discriminatory? So this isn't the end of it.
And that's been the big question. I think that when the average person thinks about the lawsuit to stop 1070, they don't think of federal preemption. They think of issues of racial profiling. Mm-hmm. But that is the ACLU's suit and some immigration rights groups' lawsuit. That's not this case. This decision by the Supreme Court will not say 1070 is okay because it's not going to racial profile. That's another case coming down. And if 1070 goes into effect, And we have all these questions about DREAM Act eligible students who get to stay here legally being harassed by cops. That kind of helps the case that it's racial profiling. It could help to stop 1070 in a later suit.
Yeah, you basically have cases happening right now that could affect cases happening down the road.
Right. And in fact, Alexander Metz, who's the executive director of the Arizona ACLU, kind of hinted that if, in fact, the injunction is dissolved, at least to part of it, as to this case, she may be back in court saying, excuse me, Judge Bolton, we have evidence here. We have a dozen plaintiffs who say even now they're being stopped based on their race. We'd like to enjoin it. Now, if she's been slapped down by the Supreme Court, I'm not sure she's going to be ready to jump right back in that.
All right. Well, keep an eye on this. And again, we could have something from the Supreme Court as early as Monday. And if that happens, all you know what's going to break loose. But we'll try to keep things in order here on Arizona Horizon. Let's keep things moving, though, Jim. We had a vote. We had a vote for a congressional District 8 this week down in Tucson. Mm-hmm. Surprise that Gabrielle Giffords, the former aide and really her, the one she supported, surprised that she won and won by the amount she won.
Well, you know, I think if you went back 6 months ago, everyone would have said, oh, whoever Gabrielle Giffords endorses is going to win the race. And then about a month ago, it kind of seemed like, oh, well, you know, there's some momentum on the Republican side. Jesse Kelly seemed like he was, you know, really had a head of steam behind him. And you saw other Republicans, you know, kind of drop out of the race for the fall and say, I think he's going to win, so I'm not even going to touch it. And lo and behold, that momentum kind of shifted back. And it, not coincidentally, I don't think, when Gabrielle Giffords kind of got engaged in the campaign those last couple of weeks, and she started making campaign events and doing some mail and doing some things like that. And you know, lo and behold, Ron Barber does win and wins convincingly. You know, I think he won by about 9 points.
Yeah. And what's good, you know, of course, what's important is, I think, for this election versus the one that's going to be in November, I think the issue is, did Gabby have some right to choose who would fill out her term? And so just her presence there, as Jim points out, made a difference. Now, that's not going to carry through. In fact, is we've got another Democrat named Matt Hines, who's a state lawmaker, who says, well, that's all very nice, and Ron Barber's a nice guy, and he does good constituent work. But we need a young policymaker there. And so this is going to get ugly, even on the Democratic side.
On the Republican side, you've got Jesse Kelly basically invited and accepting the invitation not to run again. but you've got an up-and-comer down there who's going to make some real noise for the Republicans.
Yes, Martha McSally, who was the first female combat fighter pilot, which is pretty impressive and has a military background. And she was a participant in the primary for the special election, and what by some analysis was weak on domestic issues. I'm sure that the Republican, you know, national groups will be starting to prime her now that she will be the candidate. But it's an interesting balance here from the special election to the general in the fall. A poll came out the day before the election that really called it straight up from public policy polling. And they concluded from their poll that people were really motivated to come out and vote for the Democrat because they saw it as Giffords' seat. Mm-hmm. They wanted to come out to support Gabby Giffords. I think you're right, that might not hold into the fall. But what does happen is that the electorate of that district changes because of redistricting. It's more Democratic than it is right now. That makes it really hard for someone like Jesse Kelly, who was the farthest to the right as far as the candidates we had in the special election. He was supported by the Tea Party. That's not where Martha McSally is. That makes her more of a contender going into the fall, whether she's up against Ron Barber or Matt Hines.
Jim, all signs Matt Hines is going to stay in this and get a primary for the Democrats?
Yeah, he's doubled down this week. I mean, he said, look, I'm in it to win it, and I'm here because I want to give voters a choice. Just because, as Howie said, you know, they went with Gabby's successor in the special election, who he endorsed in the special election. Mm-hmm. He dropped out of that special election race. You know, he voted for him. He campaigned for him. He said voters deserve a choice in the fall, and you know, maybe we shouldn't just let this guy waltz into the seat.
And, of course, the guy who's probably feeling the most stupid this past week is Frank Antonori, who was saying, you know, I could run for Congress, but, yeah, Jesse's going to win it, so it's not a big deal. So I'll go ahead and run for my legislative seat again. And here's Frank going Wednesday morning, what happened?
Yeah. All right. A lot of folks are kind of looking around, wondering what's going on between the Goldwater Institute and Glendale. Real quickly, it sounds as though the Goldwater Institute has a couple of lines of fire here. The first one is that the vote the city council took wasn't even valid. correct?
Right. The challenge that they're making to Glendale right now is very procedural. They're saying that of all the documents that Glendale produced, there were two key documents that they didn't produce in the deadline needed, and the public didn't have the opportunity to review them. It's a very procedural argument. The next argument you're going to see them potentially make is that this is back to that gift clause. Mm-hmm. And that has been the clause in state law that has really skewered all these past deals for Glendale. The Goldwater Institute, I mean, that's really the piece of the law that they've been arguing against a lot of things, like City North, that the government can't give a gift to a private entity, and they see any kind of subsidy that goes to a sports team as a gift. And when you look at this, the issue is that Glendale is giving a lease to, they're going to pay the Glendale, they're going to pay the Coyotes to be there, to the tune of $10 to $20 million
a year. To operate the arena.
Which
apparently takes $15 million a year to do.
Right, and the taxpayers paid for. Yes. I mean, Glendale's on the hook for it. Taxpayers paid for the arena, and now they're giving money to a team to manage it, and that's raising the question.
And one of the issues that came up, though, when the Supreme Court decided City North was, they said, looking forward, because they said we hadn't set clear guidance before, the question becomes the benefit. Now, in the case of City North, you're not using those parking spaces. I mean, we're talking about a parking garage that the city was buying it couldn't even use. Glendale will obviously make the argument that what we are getting back, and you can use economists to say, you know, sales taxes, you know, goodwill, whatever, certainly makes up for this. And that's one of those cases that it's real hard for a judge to look at and say, okay, how do you weigh this $15 million versus these sales tax revenues versus, you know, this getting, you know, perhaps a Stanley Cup playoff in the Valley or whatever?
And no bonding in this particular deal, I think, makes a difference as well as far as the subsidy issue is concerned, because the city thinks if there's no bonding, then we've kind of hit the hurdle that kind of slowed us down on the, all right, we'll see what the, Jim, I got to ask you, why can't Russell Pierce find a good table at a Mexican restaurant? What's going on here?
Well, it depends on certainly who you ask. You know, the folks who were threatening protests of a fundraiser he was supposed to have yesterday are taking credit for it and saying, hey, look, we stopped him from having a fundraiser at Macayo's. We stopped him from having it at another Mexican food restaurant downtown. And we stopped him from having this fundraiser at a third location at Central High School in the library. And Russell Pierce, his campaign and his supporters are saying, well, these places got scared off because these opponents were making threats. They were calling in bomb threats. They were threatening violence against the restaurant workers. And, you know, it's I think back to the old, you know, pro and anti Russell Pierce thing that we saw a year ago in the recall, and it's here again.
Why would Russell Pierce? I mean, I understand it, but Russell Pierce tried to have a fundraiser at a Mexican restaurant. Russell Pierce. It's just a little, it's not
well, Russell
surprising.
Russell Pierce can eat at a Mexican restaurant if he wants to.
I know, but I understand why it brought up the hackles of people who are opposed to his policies.
Well, but this point is, he's always said, I am not anti-Latino, anti-Hispanic. You know, I am anti people violating the law. So the choice of food seems to be way off. The thing that bothers me more
but come on, it's sticking it to the protesters by doing that.
But the thing that bothers me more is that some of the folks on the left, and I'll use the term loosely, who are doing the protesting, who are trying to block this, are the same people who will scream when they're shouted down at something else. There is something very anti-First Amendment about this. Whatever you believe about political fundraising or anything else, if you believe that the answer to speech is more speech, it's not to cut off speech.
Well, they weren't. They were protesting. They were exercising their free speech to protest what they thought was a slap in the face to the Latino community
for him to choose
a Mexican restaurant to have a fundraiser for re-election.
But the difference was they were doing it for intimidating purpose. They were trying to intimidate.
All politics is intimidation.
But you don't intimidate people. It's like, you know, having to cross a strike line. When it becomes more than just picketing, when it becomes intimidation against people and harassment of people who would be going there, I think you've got a problem.
All right. Time out. We got to stop it right there.
Oh, you're no fun at all.
No. I got a dinner date to meet. I'm going down to Oaxaca's for thank you all for joining us tonight on Arizona Horizon. Monday on Arizona Horizon, we'll take a closer look at the new federal policy that allows certain undocumented immigrants who came to the U.S. as children to apply for work authorization and have their deportation deferred. That's Monday at 7 on Arizona Horizon. That is it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great weekend.